Hi everyone, thanks for joining in. We'll wait for another somewhere around another 5 minutes and then start. So hi Pawan. Hi Pawan. Hello everyone. I request you all to mute yourselves.
हेलो
हेलो पवन. यस,
हाँ जी
यू आर ऑडिबल नाउ. सो हेलो एवरीवन, थैंक्स फॉर जॉइनिंग इन. एंड आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम पवन पवन भाटिया टू अनदर एपिसोड ऑफ लर्न विद एएन सीरीज. एंड पवन इज अ चार्टेड अकाउंटेंट बाय क्वालिफिकेशन एंड ही इज एक्स सी वाई एंड करंटली ही इज इनटू personality grooming and personality development. So now we can start off with the session. So requesting you Bhavan, please take over and lead this session.
Hi, good evening everyone. My name is Pavan Bhatia and I am a chartered accountant by qualification and a trainer by passion and profession. So today's session is on how to bag or how to get your first job. As all of you know that in these unprecedented times of COVID, it becomes even more difficult and even more challenging to, you know, get a good job. And given our skill set, given our credentials, given the market environment, given the number of vacancies available in the market, it becomes very challenging to, you know, to search a job. Actually, the first challenge in front of us is to identify a proper opportunity and apply, right? And we do send our CVs and it usually we do not get any response. Usually it is like no response, sir, no response, hame koi response nahi mil raha. So that has been a challenge. Now that challenge, so what today I have done in my presentation is I have divided the challenges or the bottleneck in two parts. One is before interview and the other one is during the interview. After interview, there is no bottleneck because either you get selected or you do not get a call or you get rejected and we just keep on trying. So I just want to, you know, share the presentation with all of you. Like, what should we do? Can everyone please mute their respective audios, please? Thank you. So I just want to share some insights that I have noticed, that I have learned from doing this particular, in this particular profession. Even when I was, you know, working with Ernst & Young, what I have noticed is that people do not try properly. So I have prepared a list of things I want to share with all of you. It's going to be very helpful. So directly let's start on. Okay. So this is all about me. Okay. So some insights that I could find, over internet. The average job opening attracts 250 resumes. So that means for one vacancy, usually there are 250 resumes. This is average. This is averaging out. There are 250 resumes on one vacancy. So you can imagine the level of competition that a particular individual or a candidate faces when he or she applies for a particular position. Only 2% of them, you know, are being called for an interview. So if you compute this 2% of 250, it would be like probably 5 candidates. So 5 candidates over one job. And let me tell you, if I speak about PSU jobs, if I speak about government jobs, the situation is even worse. This is what I'm speaking about, the private jobs, right? Anurag, can you please take care of the people who are joining of late? Because I have to then do it.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
So these are some insights. Like 8% of the recruiters say that their quality hire comes from employee referral. Recruiter takes an average of 6 seconds to scan your resume. You write so much, you prepare a 1-page CV, 2-page CV, 3-page CV. And actually the fight is whether to go for a one-page CV or a two-page CV. See, Anurag has already taken one session with some other expert over, you know, interview skills and curriculum vitae and resume. So I'll not speak on the basic part of it because that has already been covered by on this particular platform, and it would be it won't be great because we value your time. So I would be talking a step further. I would be taking you a step further. Everyone knows how we have to dress well. Everyone knows, we have to be present on time. Everyone knows the basics of it. But where do we lack? There is some gap between what the recruiters are looking for and what we are providing. So we will definitely speak on such topics. So moving ahead, the next thing that I really want you to know is, 1 second. Okay, so these are certain bottlenecks that we have realized, or I have actually noticed when people apply for a particular job position. So the first one is inappropriately drafted curriculum vitae resume, and either there is no cover letter, number one, or in case if there is a cover letter, it is so inappropriate that even if I would have been a HR or someone who is actually recruiting you or screening your profiles, I won't be giving you a chance even for an interview, to be honest. So what do you mean by inappropriately drafted CVs? See, we all are lazy creatures. We are extremely lazy. We just prepare one set of...
Please mute.
Anurag, please mute everyone except both of us.
Yes.
So okay. So inappropriately drafted CV means the CVs we prepare just one draft of CV or one version of CV and we circulate it everywhere. Most of the chartered accountants that I have seen have an audit heavy CV. What do you mean by audit heavy CV? By audit heavy CV means you have exposure of mostly, doing or being engrossed in auditing work, be it internal audits, be it statutory audit. It can be any of either of them. Let's say if I want to go for a taxation profile, and if I'm forwarding my CV that I have worked in statutory audit and I have done XYZ work, I have checked the compliance with Ind AS, I have done IFC assignments, and this is what I have done. I have prepared report as per SA 700. How is it useful for someone who is working in a tax profile? You tell me that. Let's say if you were the recruiter, will you hire someone who does not match with the skill set that is required for that particular profile? Probably not. So what we need to do is we need to prepare multiple versions of our CV. One version would be a general CV. Let's say if I worked in taxation, or let's say if I worked in auditing, I need to write that in my CV. I have to prepare one page, two page, does not matter. Both are equally good. None of the recruiters, there are certain recruiters, let's say Accenture. So if you upload your CV on Accenture's profile portal, they will ask for one page CV. So that's why we need to prepare both the versions. And even in both the versions, we need to prepare according to the job description or according to the profile that we are applying for. If I'm applying for statutory audit, I need to write statutory audit at the first place. If I'm not writing that, there are 90% chances because of the ATS. ATS means application tracking system or application tracking software that usually recruiters use, even Naukri or Naukri.com. or any sort of job portal uses that particular feature to screen your CV. It is not someone manually, koi aadmi nahi baitha hota samne. There's no person sitting in front of the computer and looking at your CV. No. It is just a software which there are certain keywords set by that software, the owner of that software, or the particular recruiting organization. It screens your CV. If it finds something suitable, it will shoot a mail to you. Else, it will reject you. That's why when you apply through Naukri.com or any portal per se, you find you sometimes get mails from certain recruiters or offering accounting profiles or let's say receptionist profile or some profile which is no way related to you. Why so? It is not someone manually sending you those mails. Those are all system generated mails. Some or the other thing in your CV hits that keyword which is predefined or already set by the recruiter on that particular platform, and you get the, that call or you get that mail, right? So please draft your CVs in a way that it suits the job description. Now, where to get the job description from? Question aa sakta hai ki sir, job description kahan se milega? Hame kya bata? We are freshers, or maybe we are little inexperienced, or even if we are experienced, we do not have any experience of that particular job profile where we want to go. So there is one smart way of doing it, a very simple way of doing it. Whatever profile you're applying for, just go to Google. We live in technology world. We are witnessing industrial revolution 4.0. Now this artificial intelligence, blockchain, what is it? It is all artificial intelligence. We have actually crossed that stage of industrial revolution 3.0, where we used to use computers and automation. We have moved a step further where technology has brain, where technology is able to make decisions, right? So for you, what you can do is, if you really want to know what's the job description, go to Google, just Google it up. Job description for statutory audit, job description for internal audit, job description for, let's say, transfer pricing, job description for M&A tax, international tax, and you will definitely find some or the other, job description, which the employer might have uploaded in the past over that particular platform. Because aisa to nahi hai na ki pehli baar wo job vacancy aa rahi hai. 99% cases mein, or let's be a little conservative, 90% cases mein, you will find job description over Google. Just take that, scan it properly. By scanning, I mean read it properly, go through it properly, take up some, substance from that particular job description, and see, is it matching with your particular job profile? Even if it is not matching it, do put it in your CV and start researching on it, start preparing on it. Unless your CVs do not match the job description, it is actually, you will count it as I have applied for this particular job position, but it won't, it won't result in any actionable thing happening for you. It will be a complete waste of time. Rather, go through the JD first, write something in your CV, and then move ahead. And second point that I already covered, customize your CV. Please, let's say if I'm applying for, even people who want to go for articleship training, to articleship ke liye bhi jana hai, you will apply for articleship in Big Four. See, please write certain things in your CV which matches their skill set. Otherwise, there is no point doing it. Let's say if you're applying for audit, at least write about audit. At least write something about audit that you have theoretical experience of, reading essays. If you have theoretical experience of auditing or auditing tools, or you have theoretical experience of concepts in audit. Until unless that you are not writing, it is merely a waste of time. Don't count it as an opportunity. Don't count it as you have applied for that particular position and now it will reap benefits. It will not reap any benefit. The second problem that I have seen, because I take these day in, day out, is there is lack of desire, should I call it lack of desire, or there's some sort of people are not very happy or people are not very comfortable or flexible to move to different parts of the country. Let's say if I'm sitting in Jaipur, let's say someone is sitting in Delhi, or let's say someone is sitting in Kolkata and he has been offered a job in Chennai or Hyderabad. Or at least I can speak about Jaipur because I am dealing with the Jaipur market and Jaipur students. I can speak about them. They are very reluctant or they are very skeptical about, moving to the southern part of India or sometimes even Mumbai. I don't know why. See, they are the industrial hubs of the country. They present to us the opportunity, to work for different clients. We must not restrict ourselves, that we will only work in a particular job location. I understand in certain cases, be it a male candidate or a female candidate, in certain cases, definitely there are job preferences. Definitely there are location preferences. But that does not mean that we will restrict ourselves. If in your case, there is no such restriction, please go and explore. Mumbai, Bangalore, Hyderabad is a tech city. For Hyderabad, they're saying it's going to be new Bangalore. And for Bangalore, they're saying it is going to be new Bombay. Right? So there is no point, you know, searching for job. Let's say if I'm sitting in North, searching for job in Gurgaon and Delhi. You are actually, you know, wasting your time. Why so? Why are you doing so? You won't be coming to Jaipur or you won't be coming to your hometown every weekend. And if you're coming back to, you know, if you're coming back here to your home every weekend, you are not going to mingle with the people who are working with you. Rather stay there and make some connections. So please be open to move, be open to experiment, be open to learn and be open to, you know, learn new culture. I know I have heard, I don't know, bizarre complaints like, sir, khana achha nahi milta, sir, South Indians hai, sir, cultural difference hai. I understand, yes, there is a cultural difference, but if we speak about Bangalore, sir, it's a metropolitan, Hyderabad is a metropolitan city. I don't think there must be any sort of reluctance to move there. Okay. So, please be flexible and just look at the job. Do not look at the location. One more thing. Even if you join a particular organization at a particular location, every organization has a policy of, you know, changing location, number one, and changing job profile after a certain period of time. I was associated with Ernst & Young. They have this policy of 18 months. Usually it is 18 months or 1.5 years, after which you can move to some new profile and you can also move to some new location, provided there is some vacancy at that particular location where you want to move. Right? So it is not like once you are working in Bangalore, you will be completely sitting there and you won't be able to change your job position. That's not the case. That is absolutely possible. One of my friends used to work with EY GDS, was placed at Bangalore, now is working in at Gurgaon location. So that is very much possible. So please take chances. Please do not give up on opportunities because of such petty and bizarre things of, you know, location preferences. And if you are an attempter, let's say you took some attempts, or let's say if you are an MBA, or let's say you are a CMA, a cost accountant, and you have taken considerable number of attempts to clear that examination, your first preference should be, I should bag a job, I should get a job. I will look at the situation from a different point of view. I am not a first attempter, I'm not a ranker. There are two strategies. Like in marketing, you learn two things. One is push strategy and one is pull strategy. For good products, for good candidates, there is always a pull strategy. Good companies will try and pull you. Good companies will try and pull your CV. But in case if you have taken considerable number of attempts, you have to use the push strategy. That means you have to market yourself. By marketing yourself means you need to be very open to move to certain locations, certain companies or a certain profiles, right? So do not restrict yourself. It is not the end. Your career starts at 24, 25. It does not end at 24, 25. You have a very long career of almost 30 to 40 years. You usually retire at 60. So considering that, you have a career of almost 30 years, right? And in 30 years, many people make a lot of moves. Even I made a move in my initial phase of my career. And let me tell you, the flexibility that the initial phase of career provides, it is not possible at the later stages because of various reasons. It can be, you know, family responsibilities, financial burdens and many other things. Moving ahead, multiple attempts, mediocre credentials, skill set problem and articles over internship exposure. People in Mumbai are blessed. They work in good firms. They have good clients. But people in tier 2 cities, tier 3 cities are not that blessed. They have, if I run through their resume, most of the clients would be like LLPs or maybe partnership firms or sole proprietorships, and they might have done audits. And in those audits, what we do, we just do vouching verification. do we really do audit? I don't think so. We really do audit. What we do is we just do checking. Checking and auditing are two different things, right? We prepare accounts sometimes. Preparation of accounts and auditing are two entirely different things. You need to check. You need to, you know, appraise books of accounts and audit. You need to use your technical knowledge, Ind AS, SAS, you know, to check or to appraise the books of accounts. That is something which we don't do. Now, what to do in case if we are a multiple attempter, in case if we have mediocre skills or mediocre credentials, we have done articleship from a very small, we should not call small, maybe, yeah, small or maybe a mediocre firm or a mid-sized firm. Let's not call it a mediocre firm because they are not mediocre firm. They are mid-sized firms with decent amount of work. So what to do in that case? Sir, after your examination, a lot of time, you know, or like after get your result, and also from result till campus placements, you have a lot of time. You just waste it completely. You do not join any organization. You do not join any firm. I would say, please go and join some firm. I would still suggest go post, post your examination, go and join some firm. And see, if you go and join a firm and tell them, sir, I only want to learn. I do not want any stipend. I do not want any remuneration. Just, I want to go to a good firm. Go and join a good firm where you have good work. Everyone knows in their particular locality which are the good firms. So please go and join them. Do something extra which you have already done. If you really want to carve out a place for yourself, you need to put in more efforts. Otherwise, there is no difference. Let me give you one more data which I have not mentioned in my CV, which I have not mentioned in this particular PPT. Last time around, there were 14,000 chartered accountants. Before that, there were again 14,000 chartered accountants. Before that, there were again 15,000 chartered accountants. If I total it up in three attempts, there were 50,000 chartered accountants. Now, do we have so many jobs in every 6 months that we can, you know, factor in 50,000 or 40,000 chartered accountants every 6 months, like 14,000 chartered accountants every 6 months? Do you really feel so? And in pandemic situation where people who are working in organizations from last so many years are being given pink slips. So please think from that perspective. I know it's good to have preferences, but that depends on your skill set as well. Now it is a matter of introspection. It is a matter of self-evaluation. If you are on,
hello.
Unless you're not honest with yourself, wouldn't be bagging any job, right? Please mute your audio, whosoever it is. Okay. Desired. Okay. The next problem that people face post clearing. Please mute your audio. Anurag, please mute the audio.
Actually, I am unable to mute their audio. I think it's only allowed at the time of joining. Rekha, please request you to mute your audio.
Okay.
Fine. Okay, desire to work in profile that do not match a skill set or work experience. I used to work in auditing. I have an experience of auditing. I have seen a lot of chartered accountants who want to make their career in investment banking. Now, this is a new buzzword, or it is not even a new buzzword. It has been there from last 3-4 years. It is now trending. I want to go for investment banking. So my question to you is, why did you pursue, you know, chartered accountancy? Probably you would have pursued CFA then. Why are you coming here? Because if you search and if you apply in any investment banking firm, they won't entertain you, to be honest. I am someone who speaks on the face and I'm someone who speaks very direct. Let me be very honest. They consider you as someone who does not have requisite knowledge of capital market. So they won't take you in equity research. Now, investment banking. Yes, one more thing. People say, I want to go for investment banking, but they don't know what is it. Even in investment banking, there are multiple divisions. One division that I want to speak on is in equity research. A lot of organizations like AMCs, like a big broking houses, they do hire you in equity research. Motilal Oswal, let's say DSP BlackRock. These are all big, big, big houses or investment houses or equity research houses, which definitely hire people who have investment banking profiles. If you would have been working in Mumbai or you have that sort of work experience, because in Mumbai I've seen a lot of people having that sort of work experience, they might get a chance for an internship. Otherwise, there is no point, you know, there is no chance that you will get it. So if you really want to switch to a profile which does not suit even your profession, like if I speak about investment banking, it does not have any link per se with chartered accountancy, but really you want to go for it. So there are various ways of doing it. Probably we'll discuss it later on. I have a slide on that later on. So what to do in that case? I want to switch from assurance to taxation. Forget investment banking. Even if I want to switch from audit to taxation, it becomes really difficult for me to do that. How to do that? What to do in that case? And we are reluctant in changing our CVs as well. हमने तो एक ही version बनाया है सब, हम तो वही forward करते हैं. और cover letter भी हमने तो एक बना रखा है. कभी हम JD के हिसाब से cover letter बनाते नहीं हैं. हम तो एक standard format है हमारा, because we really don't want to change our CV. Sir, this if you are going to do this way, it won't work for you. And especially in a scenario where we have 14,000 chartered accountants, especially in a scenario where things are not that rosy. So you need to change your CV, or you need to make multiple version of CV, and you need to do something else that we're going to discuss in the later slide. This is one more problem that we face, that we want to change the course of our career aspirations. The next one is unable to capitalize from job portals. This is again a problem. We all have, you know, account, or we all have created account on Naukri.com and all other platforms. But the problem is there is no response. The problem is that we are not getting what we want. The problem is not with Naukri.com. Now, in this situation, in pandemic situation, that there might be a possibility that there are or there is a lack of job. But in general sense, in case of, let's say, if everything would have been fine, if you're not getting something, or if you're not getting relevant calls from the recruiter, then there is some problem with your job portal application, or there's some problem with your account that we'll cater on, maybe with, that we'll deal later on. Inability to use and capitalize through professional social media platform, LinkedIn. Okay. LinkedIn is another platform which was the purpose of LinkedIn is to connect to people from different backgrounds or maybe similar backgrounds and create a professional network. Nowadays I see a lot of motivational posts there. I don't know why. It was never a platform to share motivational posts. It was there to share your expertise, share your yes, if you are a motivational speaker, definitely you'll put something motivational there. You cannot put rocket science or maybe a formula to have a nuclear missile. Definitely, if you're a motivational speaker, if you're a soft skill trainer, you will put something motivational there. But if you are a chartered accountant, or if you are a professional, or if you're an engineer and you're putting motivational post, once in a while it is okay, but every day posting something which is very motivational, to me it looks very odd. To many it would look very normal, but to me, if I speak, it looks very odd, to be honest. So how should our LinkedIn account be, how should our LinkedIn account look like? That is another thing that we're going to discuss in the next slide. So these are certain problems before interview. If you can see here, before interview that people face: not a proper LinkedIn account, unable to capitalize from job portals, want to work in some other, division, or want to change the course of our profession, but unable to do it. We are multiple attempters. We do not have that sort of skill set. We have done mediocre articleship. We lack desire to move from one part of the country to another part of the country because we have certain location preferences and bottlenecks. And the CV that we have drafted is a little irrelevant for that particular profile. And we are lazy enough, or we are so lazy that we are not even changing it for the sake of job. So these are certain problems. And there's one more which I've not mentioned here, because that is something which every trainer is going to tell you. So anything which is very common, I usually skip that. Lack of communication skill. Let me tell you, that is the biggest problem with people who do not get jobs. if you are unable to express yourself, probably I've not mentioned it here, I mentioned it when in the next slide. The problem is that if you are not practicing it, I have seen a lot of people saying, "Main sir, YouTube video dekh leta hun." Now, watching some video over YouTube, I have one simple question to you. Can you learn driving and swimming, you know, while watching a YouTube video? Can I driving or swimming seek sakta hun ke YouTube video dekhkar? Hardly one or two. There might be exceptions, sir, hum seek sakte hain. But most of you won't be able to do it. You have, even if you're watching something on YouTube, you have to actually implement that, practice that in the real world. You have to take a plunge in the pool and need to swim. Then only you'll learn how to swim. You need to get into your car. You need to know where is the clutch, where is the accelerator, where is the brake, how to put the first gear, second gear, third gear. So until you do not do it yourself, it is not possible. Same is the case with communication skills. If you are not speaking, if you are not practicing, you won't be able to learn it just merely by listening to a YouTube video or maybe a movie or a TV series. That is good. That is good to, you know, that is good to learn some new vocabulary. But even if you learn a new word, you won't be able to use it unless you put it in practice. So you need to put certain things in practice, then only you will perfect it. Right. So certain problems that we face during interviews, interview ke doran, during interview, what sort of problems that we face? Okay. The first and the foremost and very common and obvious cliche problem is lack of. So Jaydeep will take questions at the end. Don't worry, we'll take every question. You just type that question in the chat box and we'll take it at the end. So lack of preparation on job profile. The most cliche, the most general, the widely noticed problem is we do not have any preparation because we feel that now we are professionals. We have qualified chartered accountancy. We have qualified cost accountancy. Now we are management graduates, we are engineers or whatever profession you belong to, the job is done. No, the problem starts after qualification. Before qualification, it is all about books. Everything will be asked from the books. But later on, it is all about your skill set. Later on, it is all about your street smartness. How agile you are in terms of thinking, how flexible you are in terms of moving from one place to another, how adaptable you are to the changing scenario. I never imagined. I am someone who do not believe in taking online classes. And something that I do, recruitment training.
Samir,
please put it on mute. Okay. So I am someone who do not believe in taking, webinars and online classes. I feel and the kind of profession that I am in, which is basically interpersonal skills, which is where I need to, indulge the other person in a way that we have some sort of a rapport. And until unless that other person is not speaking, that is not possible. But even I have to change the way of, working in this COVID times. I cannot say many kar raha sab. That is not the right way of doing it. You have to change you have to be very adaptable in your Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest. Until you do not become fit or rather fittest, you won't be able to survive. So preparation on job profile. For this, what you need to do is this a very simple thing. It's a very simple phenomena that you need to follow. Please read the job description well. Number one, please read the job description well. Secondly, please read about the organization. Now, what we need to read about the organization and from where we can read about the organization. There are multiple sources from where you can gather a lot of data about the organization. The first one is, the first one would be the annual report. Annual report kaha milega? Probably on their website. If it is a listed company, you'll find annual report on their website. Usually all the listed companies, have their annual reports on their respective websites. So please download it from there. In case you are unable to find it, there is one more way of doing it. Let's say it's a very good company. Let's take one example, PRI, Pernod Ricard India. So basically it deals in spirits, liquor, right? It's not a listed company in India. It's a German brand. There it is listed, but in India it is not listed. Let's say if I want to have a look at its financials, I want to have a look at its annual report, I can download it. I can easily download it from MCA's website. It will take, I think they charge 100 rupees, and you can get it very easily. It's not a big deal. Now, what do I need to read in that particular annual report or let's say financials or their website? So there are certain things that you need to definitely remember: their annual turnovers for the current last reported period figure and their year-on-year growth, right? What all indices they are. So if you just go through their notes to accounts, you will find that auditor and some and the management who have prepared the financials, they will write information or they will discuss information about indices applicable. If you really want to learn indices, I know your academic teachers are going to teach you indices from the books, and that is also required. That is also prerequisite, or that is also very important to read the text or the law. But if you really want to actually see its implementation, just take an annual report of any company which deals in different segments and which has foreign operations, because it covers, you know, various aspects of indices, different indices, and just go through its books to accounts, and you will be able to relate to it. So their turnover, their net profits, their ratios, their let's say, yes, their future expansion plan, their hierarchy, their important ratios. These are certain things which are very important. Yes, if this group is, the people who are attending this particular session are chartered accountants, they might have read about IFC and ICFR, right? It is very easy to read about it because there are certain sections which govern it. But if you really want to read about it, go through the annual financial report. Annual report, the management will comment on IFC, the statutory auditor will comment on ICFR, and you will find it in annual report. That is called as actual hands-on learning or actual practical learning of the concepts that you have read in text, right? So preparation of job profile is all about reading about, knowing about the company where you're applying, what it does. Yes, its capital structure is also very important that you need to read from their annual report. Their turnovers, their year-on-year growth, their year-on-year growth in net profits, as well as in their sales, their expansion plans, their hierarchy, their products, which you'll find their vision, mission, value statement, their mission and vision, which is mentioned on their on their website. Please do read it. If you've seen the recruitment form of application form of ITC, they have one question: which values of ITC do you resonate to? This is what they ask. So unless you do not know what are their values, you won't be able to answer the question. Simple. You will write something which will be of your own making, which will not resonate with the values and the mission of or the objective of the company. So job profile, please read job description. It makes things amply clear what we need to prepare. Please read about the organization. Now, please read about the org. If I'm saying please read about the organization, that is applicable to an industry. Let's say if I'm applying in Big Fours. Now, Big Fours will not ask you, tell us something about EY or tell us something about PwC or Deloitte. Nobody's going to ask you. Yes, they might ask, let's say if you're applying for Deloitte USI, they might ask, why do you want to join Deloitte USI and why not Deloitte? Why not India practice? Why only global practice? That sort of question is well taken. That sort of question will be asked. But they won't ask you about, they might ask you, do you know about our businesses? Do you know about our business? Do you know about our work? Do you know about what we do in general? They might ask you that question because that's an integral part of your preparation. But otherwise, they won't ask a question like you must be aware of, let's say if I'm applying in HUL or Marico, I should know what sort of hair oil Marico sells and what sort of products or FMCG products does HUL or Marico sells, right? So that is very, very important about the company, their products, their geographical location, data from the annual report and job description. These are 5-7 things that you must prepare before going for any interview.
Yeah,
consultancy. Yeah.
Yeah. One point I want to, like, one personal experience I want to tell everyone. I was working in a consulting firm, and I gave an interview for a manufacturing company, which was into manufacturing of paper. So while I went to the went for the interview, they asked me the turnover of my organization. Of my present organization at that time, which was a consulting firm, and I did not know it. So and because of that, it was the final round of interview. I had already cleared two rounds of technical interviews, and it was, I think, the interview was with the group CFO, and he asked me this question: what is the turnover of your company? I wasn't able to tell him. And just because of that, I lost that job. Just because of that one thing. So it's even the company you are applying to, you should know at least basics about it, and also the company you are working with. That company you should be able to you should know at least 80 to 90% of their stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. I was just about to say that, because the next point is. Lack of preparation on CV, something which I've mentioned in my CV, something which I have done, and I am clueless what I've done, and I'm not aware. I have audited XYZ organization, but I really don't know what they do. I really don't know what's their turnover, what's their net profit, what sort of margin that they work on, who are their competitors. I'm absolutely clueless about what they do. That simply means two things. Either you have not done that audit, or you have not done that particular assignment, number one. The second thing is, that means you are a dummy. Or the second thing is, you have not done audit. You have just, done some sort of vouching verification, and you came back to office. Simple. It is very simple as that. They do ask questions about 3-4 things. If I speak about audit profile, they will definitely ask three to four questions that they're definitely going to put through in an interview. Is turnover of the organizations that you have audited. Is it a listed company or an unlisted company? Number one. And the turnover. Number two. Number three that they're going to ask is, what were the major observations? What you did there? Was there any observation that you noted or you brought out during that particular audit? And the fourth thing is risk associated with that particular organization. Now, this risk question is let me tell you, it's a googly. It's a trick question. Many students will answer this question in a way that they will define control risk ye hota hai, audit risk ye hota hai, and they will speak about that risk part that they've studied in audit. No, sir. He's actually not asking you about that risk. He's asking you about risk in the processes. He's actually asking about the internal IFC, internal financial control. He's asking, let's say if I'm in recent interview, just this attempt, I had a lot of students, CA students preparing this time. So in one of the interviews, Deloitte USA asked, let's say if I'm auditing a particular organization and I have a trial balance or a balance sheet, or a P&L account, P&L statement of P&L, and I see sales or revenue at 10 lakh rupees, how will I make sure it is 10 lakhs and it is not 11 lakhs? How will you make sure it is 10, it is not 11? And how will you make sure this is not inflated? This sort of question was asked. Now, the answer to the first question is why it is 10 lakhs and why it is not 11 lakhs is, we need to first go through their control points. We need to check their IFC. How strong is their IFC? How strong is their internal controls? In case if their internal controls, if their sale process, how they process their sales order, how they transact, how they approve their transactions, how the particular process flows through the system is okay on the basis of samples, the risk of the statutory auditor substantially goes down. So this is what he was actually asking. How will you make sure that the control systems are in place to make sure that the sales that the organization is saying is 10 lakhs is actually 10 lakhs and it is not 11 or 9. The answer to the second question, how will you check whether the sales is inflated or not? The answer to that question is, we need to check the related party transaction. We need to check the subsidiary holding transactions. So this is what we need to check. Now, this is something that you study in your curriculum. But unless you haven't done it or unless you do not put your brains there, it won't be possible. So please, read your CV through well. And in case if you do not have any job description with you, let's say you get a call abruptly. Ekdam se call aya, like you have an interview tomorrow. And you do not have any job profile. You do not have any data or any information about that particular profile. Yeah, ek bahut hi na sirf designation diya hua hai that you will be an executive in FP&A. Bas itna sa diya hua hai. There is no formal document defining that particular job role. In that case, the best thing to do is just go through your CV well. And let's say just search for that particular job position. And you'll be able to know what kind of work they do and related to the subjects that you've studied. Let's say FP&A will definitely involve treasury and financial management. So I'll definitely study, let's say, working capital. I'll study budgeting, little bit of budgeting and something which is there in my CV. Right? Ratios, I'll study ratios. Trend analysis, analytical procedures, I'll study that. I'll study, let's say, Forex. I'll study derivatives. I'll study all that stuff which is mentioned in FM. If the profile is not clear, only merely on the basis of the name or on the basis of a little bit of research that I've done on that particular profile. Secondly, I need to go through my CV very well. Each and every point must be audited properly. Now, how to audit your CV? How to audit your own CV? There's a very simple way of doing it. Let's say if you have mentioned that you have capitalization of existence. Yash, please mute yourself. Let's say if you have mentioned that you have checked compliance of Ind AS 16, assumingly or AS 10, whichever regime you belong to. So
but you have. अभी जो कि पहले से ही हो.
Yash, please mute your audio. So let's say if I'm checking fixed assets, I'll relate it to Companies Act, I'll relate it to CARO, I'll relate it to, let's say, auditing, to Income Tax Act, I'll relate it to, let's say, GST.
सही में नहीं दिखा रहा कि देख लो.
One second, just a second.
Delete कर दिया क्या नंबर तुमने? मैं तो
ओके
राजाओं नहीं दे सकते
आई थिंक पवन यू आर द होस्ट सो यू हैव द ऑप्शन टू म्यूट पीपल
या आई एम जस्ट सर्चिंग फॉर इट वन सेकंड Fine. So moving on. So I was actually speaking on CV, and as far as technical stuff is concerned, it completely depends on the job profile and whatever you have mentioned in your CV. And the second thing is general HR questions. There are certain things which are mentioned in your CV. I want to share one instance which happened with one of the students. So that student actually mentioned that he is an avid reader and he loves to read books. So he went for an interview. Interview went well. So it went on for 40 minutes. So initial 30 minutes, it was all about technical and some general HR question like what are your strengths, weaknesses, where do you see yourself 5 years down the line and all that stuff. It all went well. Now the interviewer was quite convinced that he will definitely go for that particular candidate. And when he was just running through his CV, he saw that that person has read a book or that person reads. He asked, which book have you read? He named one book. unfortunately, actually he didn't read that book. He bluffed it in his CV. And unfortunately, the interviewer have read that book. So when the interviewer has read that book, he was completely aware of the information mentioned in that particular book. And that person only read the prelogue of that particular book. And he was actually bluffing. And after a few minutes, the interviewer was not convinced. He said, "Sir, bluff kar rahe ho kya? Have you really read the book?" And the candidate confessed, "No, sir. I just read it like few pages of that book and I'm just currently reading it." The entire interview which happened before this question was now in question. He was actually questioned more. He was even, you know, there was more scrutiny of his candidature in that particular interview. And though he was selected, but it created a big question mark on interviewer's mind. So lack of integrity or bluffing during the interview is something which can go, you know, against you and which can be very detrimental to your candidature. As far as lack of integrity is concerned, a lot of organizations nowadays ask one question. I don't know, like many trainers have different take on this. I usually keep a very modest answer. And the question is like this. Let's say if you are dealing on behalf of a particular organization and you are dealing with a government department on behalf of the organization and that government department is asking for a bribe, how will you handle this? And this will happen a lot with people who work in taxation or who go for taxation division or people who work in construction industry or people who work with government departments. This is a very normal affair because you know that how bureaucracy works and people day in day out face such a situation where they're asked for some sort of bribe or maybe some sort of, you know, favors in kind or cash. So how will you handle such a situation? Like many trainers, I know certain trainers who say, no, we'll pay bribe and that is acceptable in India, but that's not the correct answer. Let me be very honest with you. You will be thrown out of that interview if you answer this way. Ever say that you will bribe them. The best way to answer such a question is, I don't know whether this thing has been covered in earlier sessions or not, but since I have spoken about it, I'll let me complete this particular point. So the best way to answer this question is to simply say that, sir, we will first take, we'll follow the hierarchy, we'll get in touch with our seniors. So the counter question that you get is, let's say you are the senior and you are the one who is individually handling this project, what will you do? So simply tell them that, sir, I will not bribe. It is against the organization's policy. Each and every organization has a very, very strong anti-bribery policy. If there are any there is any article who is attending this session and who is working in Big Fours, or let's say if there's anyone who has worked with a Big Four or any multinational company, they will know it very well that they have a very, very strict anti-bribery policy. And someone who has worked in tax will know it very well. Because I worked in indirect taxation. So I actually have seen that policy, anti-bribery policy. And it is the companies, the multinationals are completely against it. So please do not bluff. Please do not, give them a chance to question your integrity. Here, what you will say, no, sir, I will not bribe it. Number one. The reason being very simple. Now you need to cite certain example. You can say, sir, considering this as my own organization, considering it as a situation where I am actually hampering my own organization's goodwill. Because if we see in the past, there are a lot of organizations, let's say Satyam, who just for the short-term gain, just for the short-term gains, did something and it actually tarnished age. Actually completely destroyed the company. So I will never let it happen to my own company. So in that way, for short-term gains, I'll not do it. Probably I'll look for a legal recourse. Judiciary solution or a legal recourse. This is a simple way of answering such a question. Right? And there might be many questions. Many, many questions. Ki ye particular profile hi kyun? या अगर आपको कहीं और ऑफर मिल जाता है तो आप वहां चले जाओगे क्या? Such questions are being asked. So please be modest. Even if you're sounding too modest, try and be modest. I'm not saying bluff. I'm not saying be fake. I'm saying be modest, be honest. Now honesty does not there is a very thin line between being let's say naive and being honest. Being naive is being a fool. Seedha hona ya bevkoof hona alag baat hai. Don't be a person who is don't be naive. Be honest. Be honest with your answers. But the bigger picture here is, will you be losing a job, or will that be a question on your job? Answer that question in a way that it does not impact your job, right? And bluffing during interview. I have seen a lot of students, when being asked a question, simply say anything. And by anything means any bizarre thing, weird thing in that particular interview. That is something which is not very much entertained or appreciated by the interviewer. Sometimes there might be a situation that you don't know a particular answer. Clearly tell them at the moment you are unable to recall. Simple. At the moment you are unable to recall the question. But that should not happen in 8 out of 10 questions. 10 puche aur 8 mein aisa jawab mila. In that case, you are not prepared and you should go back and prepare yourself. Because if you are unable to recall 8 questions out of 10, then you are not supposed to sit here and you do not deserve to sit here. It is very simple as that. So the next problem that we face is communication or English. This is something very common, and I prefer not to speak on this. You all are well aware of how to deal with this problem. Maybe... sir, please mute your audio, whosoever it is, Galaxy something. Galaxy M40.
You can mute him.
Yeah, I'm doing that. Okay, so the next point is unable to communicate effectively, unable to put through my point of view to the interviewer. Now, what is an interview? Interview is just knowing interpersonal views. It is merely how we are interacting today, right? If when you go out with your friends, when you go out with your family and you interact over a cup of coffee, just make it more formal, just make it a little more technical, it becomes an interview. The other person, the person sitting on the other side, the interviewer, does not know you. So something that you're going to tell him, he will definitely believe it. So that is bona fide true, until unless it comes in question, until unless there is some sort of a doubt, right? So interview is something, one of the easiest activity to crack, to be honest. Yeah, sometimes you do not, sometimes you fail, sometimes you successfully clear it. But interview is something which is very easy to crack, in my opinion. Some of you might be thinking, kya bol rahe hain, ye pagal ho chuke. No, that's not the case. What's the trick of cracking interviews? Appear in as many interviews as possible. Give as many mock interviews as possible. Be it your cousin, be it some expert, be it some teacher, be it someone working in any organization, ask them to take your interview. Anything. That will actually, create a knack for answering question, right? And you'll become more comfortable. As far as English is concerned, we have already spoken about it, how to work on that. And this is the biggest barrier that comes your way in clearing the interview. One more thing
I would like to add here, yeah. Pawan, most people, when they get rejected in an interview, if they give, let's say, 2 or 3 interviews and all those 2 or 3 interviews, they get rejected. They get, they get very demotivated and very sad. And that is not the right thing to do, And what happens is that they are so demotivated, then next time when they get an interview call, they are either very nervous or they are very scared. They sometimes don't even go for the interview. Because they are scared. So that is not the right approach. Even if you get rejected for 2 interviews, 3 interviews, keep searching for that job with the same vigor. Keep attending interviews. Rejection in interview is not at all something to be ashamed of. To be honest, personally, I have a lot of experience of getting rejected in interviews. I have got rejected in at least 30 interviews. There was the time where I was searching for a job for around 3 months, and in those 3 months I gave somewhere around 15 to 16 interviews and got rejected, and then finally I got selected in some company. So it's not that if you have got rejected for 2 or 3 interviews, then you just stop giving interviews or stop going for interviews. It's definitely not that. So like I told you, I have a lot of experience on rejection, and I think I am the best person to speak on rejection, at least.
It happens. I mean, rejection happens. That's not something very big or to be ashamed of, as Anurag very aptly put. It's not like that's the last opportunity that you're going to get into a particular job role or a particular corporate. Other opportunities will definitely knock your door, provided if you're not prepared, then it's your fault, boss. Sorry. If you're not prepared, you're bound to get rejected. But if you're prepared and still get rejected, that's not a big deal. Just knock that door again, or knock some other door again, and you will definitely get through it. So that's not a big deal. Coming back to body language. So I'll not speak about the normal body language gestures that you need to follow in an interview, like wishing the panel, and how you should move your hands, etc. That probably that has already been covered in the previous sessions. What I want to speak on is, nowadays we are having a lot of telephonic interviews, Skype calls, or let's say interview over virtual mode, right? So how to deal with that? That is something which is that is also very similar to the interview, face-to-face interview, but the medium is very different. So what you should do in that case? The first thing that you should do in that case is search for a place in isolation. Search for a place in silos, which is very silent, where there is no movement. Like if you have noticed, even in this particular session, there was a lot of noise, background noise coming from from different participants' place. Now you imagine if that happens in a real interview scenario, how embarrassing that would be for a candidate. So better look for a place or sit at a place which is silent, which is in silos, which is in isolation, and where there's no disturbance or movement, number one. Secondly, please wear formals. Interview is happening at home or interview is happening virtually does not mean we'll be wearing, let's say, t-shirts or maybe casuals. That's not the right way of dressing, right? Even in a virtual interview, you need to wear a suit. I have, a lot of candidates or a lot of students ask me this question, sir, itni garmi hai, how will we wear suits? Now, my simple submission to them is, let's say if it's a face-to-face interview, wherever you are going for that interview, it is going to be an air-conditioned premises. In case if you're attending an interview or if you are appearing for an interview, at your home or at your premises, please sit at a place which is a little cool, where the temperature is below or around 20-23 degrees, where you can wear a suit properly, or where you can wear a suit appropriately, right? The third thing that I want to speak on is, please keep a copy of your CV alongside you whenever you're appearing for that virtual interview. Please keep a pen. Please keep a piece of paper, because sometimes they ask you to solve something. Sometimes they ask you a question and they say, please jot it down and solve it for us. So please keep these things beforehand, even before interview. Let's say I am not very used to, use Zoom or Skype or let's say Google Duo, or let's say recently PwC SDC had a virtual campus just few days ago, and they, took it over Google Meet. Now, let's say if I am not very comfortable using Google Meet, what I need to do is I need to download Google Meet. I need to run or maybe have a session with one of my family members, like how it works, to understand the functionality. And then when I'll get little comfortable, I'll be able to deliver. Let's say something happens, some goof up happens when you're appearing for an interview. That would be very embarrassing for you. And even that does not create a good impact on the interviewer. they don't take you that they feel that you are not very tech savvy or you are not very prepared or keen in attending that particular interview. So better prepare in a way, prepare beforehand and be very friendly and handy with the technology that you are using. It can be any platform. It can be Zoom. Like before this webinar, me and Anurag had a call for 15, 20 minutes. And the problem was I was unable to, you know, my voice was not audible. So I have to fix it up properly. I also attended a few days ago. I attended some webinar where my system, I don't know, there is some enmity with the Zoom platform. It does not allow Zoom to, the voice feature does not work on my laptop. So I have to get it fixed. So please do it before and all these are very petty things, small things that you need to take care of and do take care of it before the interview. As far as body language is, one more thing, please preferably use a earphone or headphones. That is very, very important. If you're not using earphones or headphones, because earphones and headphones have this quality of, you know, noise cancellation. Otherwise, let's say if a fan is there in my room and there will be a lot of noise, there will be a lot of disturbance, a constant disturbance or a noise of that fan. Better use a headphone or better use an earphone. So that is all about, you know, body language in an interview. Like it is, to be honest, comparatively less stringent, easier when you give a virtual interview than a manual or face-to-face interview. Because there they check your, like how you sit, how do you move your hands, are you slouching on the chair or not, your face, your smile, everything. Everything is visible. That is something which is not possible over virtual platforms. So it is relatively easier than the face-to-face interview. Even in PSUs, I've mentioned one example here. In PSU, when you appear for a PSU job, they have a panel of 6 to 7 interviewers. And one of them is always a psychologist. And that particular psychologist, he or she, whosoever it is, will not ask a single question to you. Will not even ask a single question. They will just look at you. You know, they'll have a constant smile on their face and they will just notice your body language. So whenever you bluff, whenever you lie, whenever you try and make a fool out of them, they will catch you. Because they are very experienced and just through your body language, just analyzing your body language and just the way you move your hands, like fidgeting your hands, if you're sweating, they'll come to know that you're anxious. So body language plays a pivotal role or a vital role in your interviews. And please keep a smile. Even if it is a virtual interview or a face-to-face interview, please keep a smile. Do not giggle. Do not laugh. There's a difference between smile and giggle and laugh. Just keep a pleasant smile. Not asking the right questions. This is again a big troublesome area. A lot of students do not ask the right question. At the end of the interview, one of my students did a goof up with Deloitte. He had a great interview. And at the end, one of his friend told him ki yahan pe na gym fees reimburse hota hai, matlab is particular organization mein gym fees jo hai wo reimburse hota hai. And he was a, like, he used to work out in a gym. So what the question that he asked at the end of the interview was, do you reimburse the gym fee? Does the organization reimburse the gym fee? This is not the right question to ask. Is it a 5-day working? This is not the right question to ask. How many leaves will I get? This is not the right question to ask. Now then, what is the right question to ask? The right question to ask in current scenario, let's say tomorrow, if I would have been someone who will be appearing for an interview, I would have asked, sir, in this pandemic situation or in this unprecedented situation, how the organization is taking care of its employees, how the organization is making sure that the business is up and running. So what is the BCP plan for this particular organization in such a pandemic situation? You can also ask questions from their annual reports. Aap unke annual reports se bhi question pooch sakte ho, but for that, you need to be thorough with their annual reports and figures. And sometimes this question backfires, this strategy backfires. Because let's say if you ask something from their annual report, something from their financial, what they will do, they will say, okay, what do you think? What should have been our case? What do you think? What should be the solution to this particular problem? What do you think? What should have been? What should we have? we would have been done doing in the organization that we're disclosing it that way. So this question might backfire, but it sounds brilliant. It looks like you are well researched. You have done full research and you are very keen in joining that particular organization. So please ask the correct question. Please ask the right question. There are certain cliche questions also that you can ask. What is the organization hierarchy? As a fresher, what all trainings would be available to me? These are certain questions that can be asked. What do you expect from a fresher? Do not ask what is the job description. Do not ask what's the job role. Do not ask that because you must be aware of that particular thing. But you can ask what do you expect from a fresher? What sort of trainings would be available to me when I will join the organization? Such questions can be asked. Not knowing the overall business model of the client one has worked on during articleship and internship. This we have already spoken at length. Please be aware of whatever you pursue or whatever you do during articleship. I would recommend if there is any article in this particular audience or any delegate who is an article here, whatever work you do, please keep the track of it. Please keep, if possible, please take that with you, like over mails, if that is possible. Whatever work you do, you must be aware of what you are doing, because later on when you clear your examination, you tend to forget what you have done during articleship. So better keep a track of that. Better keep, okay, just maintain a log what you are doing. Just maintain a particular notebook or maybe an Excel file or maybe in some other mode or on some other tool, that what you have done during articleship, what all clients have you handled, what sort of work you have done. So this is very, very important, right? Moving on. So these were the problems or these were the bottlenecks that comes in your way in cracking your interviews. We have not only spoken on the bottleneck, we have also spoken on this solution. Now there are certain things that we need to do. So the next slide is all about the solutions. We have already spoken on these things, but there are certain issues which have not been solved till now and we'll speak on that. Okay, so let's move on to the next slide. Okay, so all the people who are qualified chartered accountants here or cost accountants or MBAs or anyone, any professional, these are certain job portals where you need to make an account or where you need to have a presence, right? The first one is Naukri. Everyone has an account on Naukri. That's not a big deal to have. The second is Randstad India. The third one is Michael Page India. Michael Page India is a well-known recruitment consultant. Basically they have presence in like a lot of countries in the world. It's a well-renowned recruitment consultant, but let me be very honest with you. They will help you. They usually help people who have a little bit of experience. They probably might not be able to offer. Might not be able to offer, you know, help to freshers, but I will offer something. Phenom Placement, they are available. They are also a Mumbai-based recruitment consultant or a recruitment portal, job portal. Please do make account on this. What you can do is you can take a picture of this or whatever, just jot it down somewhere and visit their profiles and visit their portals. And you will be able to relate to what I'm saying. Fast Careers is another one. They usually become active, you know, post results, post CA results. So, currently, probably they won't be able to, you know, give you any sort of assistance. The next one is IIMjobs.com. They usually post jobs for IIM management graduates like MBAs. But if you go to their page, you will find certain opportunities related to investment banking for fresher chartered accountants. They do mention CA / CMA / MBA. So this is another platform where you need to do it, where you need to visit and keep visiting for or keep applying for getting an opportunity. The next one is LinkedIn. LinkedIn, as all of you know, I hope most of you have an account over LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a, it's a slow solution. It will not give you, result in a short run. It takes little time to build on, but it is a very, very effective tool or it is a very, very effective portal to have an account on. Right now, next that I want to speak on is Naukri.com. Now everyone has an account on Naukri. सबके पास Naukri.com पे account है. That's not a big deal. सबने बना रखा है account. इसमें कुछ भी नया नहीं है. But the problem is the way we write things, the way we present ourselves, the way we portray ourselves over that platform is a cause of concern. We do not write things. We have to be very specific. We have to be very specific. का मतलब है, if I want a job in, let's say, taxation. So I need to upload a CV in a way, or I need to upload my CV which speaks on taxation. I need to present, or I need to create an account and state data which is very much related to taxation. I have to be very specific that I've worked on FTP, I've worked on customs, I've worked on, let's say, international taxation, transfer pricing provision section 92C. You have to be very detailed and you have to be very comprehensive while preparing this Naukri.com. Just open the Naukri.com, just make an account on this. Just try and make an account on this and you will be able to relate to what I am saying. You will first, you know, enter normal data like your name, etc., etc. And it will ask for your internship experience. It will ask for your location. Now people, let's say if I am in Jaipur, what people will do, they will say we are looking for a job in Jaipur, Delhi, NCR. That's it. Because you can at max choose 3 locations for preferred job location. Why so? Why not to diversify? Why not to put Delhi, NCR as one location, let's say Mumbai as second and Hyderabad as third? Why not? Because I am then restricting myself to that particular location that I'm choosing. If I'm choosing location from different cities, probably I'll get call from, you know, recruiters based out of Mumbai, recruiters based out of Hyderabad or Bangalore or Kolkata or Chennai. If I'm putting preferred location as Chennai or preferred location as Hyderabad or Bangalore. Bangalore per se is not South India. Bangalore is Bangalore is the next Mumbai. Let me be very honest with you. It's a proper metropolitan city where you get North Indian food, where you get North Indians, and it's a metropolitan city. So please be open to move to that city. Please be open to move to Mumbai. People from northern part of the India, please be open to move to Mumbai or western or southern part of India. Next one, LinkedIn. Okay. So Naukri.com, I just wanted to speak on Naukri.com, which is all about making an effective profile, being very specific. Even in your CV, be very specific. What all value additions you have done? Give statistics, give data. Like you were able to do, you found out an observation or you observed something and it resulted in XYZ amount of saving to the company, right?
Yeah.
So please be very specific. Please be very specific even on job portals as well as on your CV. That probably might have been covered in the previous section about the CV.
Okay, I'm right, sir.
Mm. Okay, LinkedIn. So let me show you my LinkedIn account if possible. Okay. I am just showing this to explain certain concepts here. So this is not an ideal LinkedIn account, to be honest, right? But I had certain things here which I have removed and I have made some certain changes yesterday itself. I want you to do something with your LinkedIn account. The first thing that you need to do with your LinkedIn account is Okay. The first thing that you need to do with your LinkedIn account is you need to have a very professional picture. So I am a speaker. I am someone who you know, participates in a lot of training programs. So I have put in a picture which actually portrays that I am a speaker, right? I can put a normal picture here as well. I can put a normal professional picture. It has to be a professional picture. This is not Instagram. This is not Snapchat. This is not Facebook. Please do not put those pictures here. Please keep this in mind that you have to put a very professional picture here. So this is all about this is all about your profile. This is what you are. this is summary of you. Understand it that way. This is your teaser. If you are a movie, this is your teaser. So I have actually put a lot of things here. You can also put fresher chartered accountant. This very simply you can put it. You can also put a very fancy thing here, or not, it should not be called fancy thing, but a very catchy, let's say paraphrase here, that helping organizations to manage taxation, fresher chartered accountant. This way you can put it. So you need to, or you can also put it like something that you have done for the organization. So this is basically a teaser of your particular profile. Please do fill it. Don't keep it blank. Write something here. Now, writing looking for an opportunity, fresher chartered accountant looking for an opportunity, that I would not recommend you to write that way. Please. Rather, write something of value. Write something which actually portrays your talent. Right? So, this has to be there. This has to be properly drafted. The next thing that I want you to do, or want you to explain, is the about thing. Yes, this one, about. Now here you can put something in detail that what you have done. Now, if you are a job seeker, like in this particular webinar, I feel most of you are job seekers. So do put things from JD. Like, let's say you are looking for a job in international taxation, or let's say you are looking for a job in transfer pricing. Assume that you're looking for a job in transfer pricing. So what you need to write here is very specific things about transfer pricing that you know, you have an idea of, you know, you are a fresher chartered accountant and with XYZ marks or XYZ rank, and you have in the past worked on transfer pricing assignments wherein you have worked on section 92E, XYZ. Like, take things from the job description, just find out job description for transfer pricing profile, pick and choose certain words and put it here. As simple as that. So this has to be filled. It gives you an option to write 2000 words. 2000 words. That's a lot of words. Please do fill it. Don't keep it blank. Please. Now the next thing that I want to speak on is your URL. So when you go here, like, you can edit your URL. I have actually recently edited my URL. So one second. Is the PPT visible, Anurag?
Your profile is visible.
Okay.
Right now.
One second. Okay.
One more thing I wanted to add here is that I see some posts from fresher chartered accountants who write that they are looking for a job in finance. Or finance, comma, accounts, comma, taxation, comma, audit, you know, and these posts which mentions their multiple interests, these are not really, you know, it shows their lack of focus, and it shows that they are confused. So you should not be putting a post that, you know, you're looking for a job in any profile that you get. So you should be specific and mention one or two of your interest areas only.
Right. So be very specific about what you are looking for. This is what Anurag is trying to say. Definitely. That's the trick everywhere. That's the trick with CV. That's the trick with your Naukri or any sort of account that you have over recruitment portals. Or that is a trick here as well. Right. So if you see here, edit intro, let me show you again. So I went here, at the bottom you see profile, URL, email, WeChat ID, etc. Just press this, and if you press this, you will be able to edit your custom URL. So this is my edited URL. If you see your URL, it will have some alphanumeric digits here. It'll have your name and some dash, some numbers, and then some alphabets, right? That does not look good. So please edit your URL, right? And make it something more recognizable, make it even more citable, right? A lot of people write that in your CVs nowadays. Definitely you can put it in your CV. No problem as such. Not at all a problem, right? The next thing, so please edit URL. Now here is some ad profile section, right? Here you can go to feature option and upload certain things here. Like you can upload your presentation, your articles, your post, even some links. Let's say you have participated in some webinar as an MOC or you have participated. Just put a link here. Just add a link here. If you are into writing, if you have, you know, in the past you've written some articles or you have published, your articles have been published somewhere, please give link here, or please put that link here. Please put that article here. Please put some post here. So fill this particular field, fill these fields. And there's one more option in media. What you can do is you can shoot your own video introducing yourself just for 30 seconds and put it here. Please put it here. So that's my recommendation. Please do it. A lot of people might not have done it. A lot of people, even I have not done it. I will also do it. I have recently removed my introduction from here. So please do it. Okay. Ask for if we go to the bottom of the page, you will find recommendations, right? And it says, ask for recommendation. Please ask for recommendation from your managers. Please ask for recommendation from your seniors. Please ask for some recommendation from someone in CA profession. Now, what's the point of asking for a recommendation? How does it help? See, directly nothing helps, to be honest. But if people, stalk your profile, if people just see your profile and they see some recommendations, the recommendation is something wherein people appraise you, where people appreciate your work, where people acknowledge your efforts, right? So do ask for a recommendation. Let's say if you are an article, you can ask this recommendation from your principal or some senior working in your office. If you are already a qualified chartered accountant, you can also ask it from your principal or some senior. And preferably, let's say if you are looking for a job, it must be preferably from someone working in that industry. So this is all about, LinkedIn account. There are certain more things that I need to share. 1 second. Okay, so edit URL. Yes, your name should not be in capitals. That is very obvious. You don't need to write your full name in capitals. Headline means where I show you the teaser part, right? That I am XCY, X Bharti Infratel. I am a chartered accountant, where you will be writing, like you people write chartered accountant looking for job in finance, accounts, taxation. That is the headline. Feature, where I told you that you need to upload a video, 30 seconds video or articles that you have published about, where I told you that there are 2000 words where you can put things, right? This is, this is very important. Certifications. If you have some certifications, let's say if you have, a lot of people have done, like certification, like certification on Tally. Or there now, nowadays, there are a lot of, online platforms providing certifications. For example, you can pursue a lot of certification on Coursera. You can pursue a lot of certification on EDX. You can pursue a lot of certification on LinkedIn Learning. It is available for free for 1 month. Like if you want to learn SAP and you can learn it there. So you can put in skills and certification part. Now, last but not the least, sending personalized connection requests. I have seen, or even I used to do it earlier. I have changed how I connect with people. A lot of people, just click connect. Like if you're doing it through mobile phone, then also there is an option. If you're doing it through, let's say, on a computer, by using a computer on a system, then also there's an option. You just need to open the profile. Let's say, if I can show it to you. 1 second. Just a second. Just hold on. Okay, let me see who are the participants. Okay, so we have, let's say Anima Jain, right? Let me type Anima Jain. So I'm unable to find it. Like, probably this is the one. Right. Let's say if I open her profile, and if I really want to connect to her, what I will do, I'll go here, more. And there's one more option which I'm unable to find here. Okay. Connect. Okay. Yes. Your is on the way. You can add a note to personalize your invitation. So add a note. So whenever you are sending someone a request, do write that you want to connect to that person's request, right? That person's profile, and then send it. Otherwise, there is no point, just clicking on connect and connecting with that person. Let's say if that person is a senior, that person is senior to you, right? Let's say that person is a partner with Big Four. So what you can do is you can very respectfully tell him that, hello, sir, my name is this, or I'm a chartered accountant. I want to be a part of your professional network. Please give me an opportunity to connect to you over LinkedIn, or please give me an opportunity to connect to you and learn from your network. Simple. Just write this, thanks, and send a connection request. Unless you don't do it, there is no point doing it. Better you do it. Better you send request in a personalized way, right? So this is the second thing or second solution, how you can do it. Like over LinkedIn, it's very slow. You need to write every day. You need to write, content every day, engage with your audience, connect with people. Let's say if you're looking for a job, connect with HRs. Try and let's say if you see a post that they are asking for some candidates, or where they're asking you to apply, do apply. Do not stop. Let's say you are not getting any response from any recruiter. You have applied at 100 places with thousands of recruiters, but you're not getting any opportunity. Does not matter. Please keep doing it. Consistency is the key here. And you never know. Some of my students who applied at some places in February are getting calls today. So you never know when will you get a call. So trust your journey, trust your destiny, and keep working hard and keep consistently applying on a particular for a particular position or on whatever opportunities you have. The next thing that I want to discuss is some of it I've already discussed. Say if I really change my profile, I am from auditing segment. I really want to change it to taxation. I am someone, throughout my articleship or throughout my training or throughout my internship, I've worked in auditing, but I now want to work in taxation. How to do it? The best way, or let's say if I am an attempter, I have taken many attempts to clear a particular examination, or I've done it through, let's say if I'm a management graduate, I've done it through a very, let's say a very normal college, not an IIM or not a good B school, but a very mediocre or generally not known big school. So in that case, what should I do? So the best way of doing it is to start small, to start with a mid-size or a boutique firm, right? Build your profile, build yourself in that particular domain, and then move on to the big firms. Let's say if I want to work in investment banking. So what I can do is, there are a lot of firms in Hyderabad, there are a lot of firms in Mumbai, which do offer internship opportunities, which do offer jobs to chartered accountants. So I can associate and I get good work. I make my profile, and then probably I'll move to, let's say, tax division of Big Fours, or let's say Motilal Oswal or some AMC, dealing with equity research. So first, if I do not have that domain knowledge, if I do not possess that sort of skill or qualification, I need to start small, need to work in that firm, and then move on. The next thing is, this is not very common in India, but I've seen in different countries people doing this, going for internship. In India, it is not very, it's not a common practice that we observe. Like post-qualification, people pursuing internships. Yes, that is also possible. Let's say after chartered accountancy, you can pursue. Let's say if you want to go for M&A profile, and there is some small firm, or there's a boutique firm providing you that small opportunity to pursue internship for 3 months, 6 months, or a year. And if you want to make a career in M&A, please go and join, because your profile is not suitable for that particular skill set. And McKinsey, Bain, S&P is not going to come to you and hire you for that particular job role, right? But you want to make a career in M&A, so better go and join some internship program with a small firm or a mid-sized firm or a boutique firm and build some profile and then move on to the big firms. That is another way of doing it. The last thing or the last thing that I want to discuss in this entire presentation is pursuing additional qualification, pursuing something, some other qualification. Let's say if I want to pursue data science. So I need to acquire that skill. I need to pursue a qualification. I need to take that diploma and then go for it, right? If I want to go for equity research, if I want to go for investment banking, probably I need to go for CFA first. But in the meanwhile, I also need to explore certain opportunities where I have been given a chance to pursue internship and have a hands-on experience, on those particular things. So this was all about, what are the problems that we face, their solutions, how we should apply job portals, what sort of profile we should portray on job portals, how our LinkedIn account should look like, how do we connect with people. We need to post every day, engage with them. I need to apply everywhere, anywhere and everywhere possible. Which should be very much related to where I want to work. It should not be a cold calling anywhere and everywhere, but the cold calling should be at places or having opportunities which align with my objective. So this is the way we apply. So I thank you all for this patient listening. As far as I'm concerned, I'm done with my presentation. Anurag, do you want to add on something?
Well, I just wanted to take some of the questions. I have already, taken some questions typed on the chat box.
Right.
But there was one question particularly from someone who said that I've been working with PwC SDC, and in my CV, should I mention only PwC or should I mention PwC SDC? So what my opinion on this is that the person should always mention PwC SDC, because there is no shame in working in an exactly. SDC people think that the quality of work is very low. It's definitely one level lower than the PwC India, but not too low. And if I tell you that I have a friend who is a manager working with PwC SDC Calcutta. He's in Calcutta. He's Calcutta based. And he's a manager there, and I just spoke to him I think day before yesterday only, and he told me that there is still hiring going on in PwC SDC, because they are growing even in this time of COVID, where in most places either people are losing jobs or there is a hiring freeze. Even in such a situation, PwC SDC is hiring. So what is the shame in mentioning PwC SDC in your CV? That I didn't understand. So what is your opinion on this?
You're absolutely right. You put it through very well. That there is no point lying on your CV. Today you can write PwC on your CV, and tomorrow they'll call you for an interview, and when they inquire, then you have to say that yes, I have worked with PwC SDC. What's the point of getting embarrassed in front of the interviewer? There's no point doing it. Rather, whatever you are doing in PwC SDC, write it in a way that shows, that portrays that you are actually adding value to whatever you are doing there. So my suggestion to you would be, as someone working in PwC SDC, if you really want to look for a change, you would be able to change maybe to Deloitte USI or maybe global units. Number one, there's RSM also. RSM is one organization which also works the same way. You can also switch, to India practice later on. That actually completely depends on your work ex. That completely depends ki aapne kitna kaam kiya hai. So there is no point, you know, lying on the CV. To be very honest, please don't lie on your CV. And there are ample opportunities available, even if you have worked in, you know, in a global unit or a global practice of a Big Four. All the global practice units of Big Four are still open to you. Assurance segment and even, let's say, internal audit segment in Big Fours are still open to you. As far as industry is concerned, KPOs are open to you. So please, do not lie on your CV, right? I can see. Also, the one question is actually directed to me. Why Mr. Pawan started self-employment?
And one more thing that I wanted to add here. I told you that my manager is my friend is a manager in PwC SDC Calcutta. And he got an opportunity to work onshore on secondment for 6 months in USA in Florida. So how many people who are working in the Indian PwC India or the Big Four Indian units get an opportunity to work in US for 6 months? I think there will be hardly anyone. But in PwC, like in the offshore units, be it PwC offshore, be it Deloitte or be it someone else, there are a lot of opportunities. If you stick there, if you work there for 1 or 2 years or 3 years, then you will most of the times you will get an opportunity to go abroad and work there on a project for at least 2-3 months or 6 months, which is very rare in the Indian thing. So there is a lot of exposure in the offshore units. And you should never think that against joining an offshore unit. That's my take here.
And if you've already joined a global unit, if you only joined a global practice, what is the shame of disclosing it? I don't feel there is any shame in disclosing it. And let me tell you, offshore model is the model of future. You will see a lot of offshore companies, or a lot of firms, getting into this offshore model of working in down 5 years from today. So please don't consider yourself as someone inferior, or don't consider that particular profile as inferior. Definitely, you should look for something better than this, but there is no shame in disclosing it. There's one question: after doing CA, should we do financial modeling course from best institute in India to get into investment banking profiles in boutique or any other big companies? Sir, definitely you can pursue financial modeling course from any institute or whichsoever is the renowned institute offering such course. But I would still recommend, like recently I shared one opportunity with my close group where there was no such requirement of any sort of financial modeling certificate or qualification. They just wanted the candidate to have decent understanding or decent hands-on experience on MS Excel. Right now, if you pursue financial modeling, definitely you will have an edge over others. So you can do it. But my suggestion would be to please go and apply in a boutique firm in Mumbai or Hyderabad, work there for some time, and then take a switch. Now, as far as pursuing some additional qualification or some skill-based course like financial modeling, definitely that will add on to your. Don't think about money. This is not something you are making an expense on. This is basically an investment. Consider it as an investment. This will definitely reap benefits in short run and in long run as well. So you can pursue it. Rather focus on getting an internship or a job with a boutique or a small or a mid-size investment banking organization or a firm. Anurag?
Yes. That's my take also. If you are actually interested in investment banking, then you should consider, maybe CFA or an MBA or even a financial modeling course. And even if you have to cut down on salary, on an immediate basis, it will always be better for you in the long run.
Okay, so Saket has a very interesting question. Like every organization has a different website he's talking about Tellio, which is one portal. I know it very well. And he's actually asking me a question. Is there any way to bypass it? So what he's trying to say, if he's if he's still attending the session, because I can see only 1918, candidates attending the session. So he's asking, is there any way to bypass it? Saket, we can connect offline on this. But as far as answer, if I want to answer your question here itself, why do you want to bypass it? If your particular profile is already available with the company's job portal, why do you really want to bypass it? Usually, in case if you have already appeared for an interview, the cool-off period is just 6 months. And 6 months is no big time, right? So there is no need to fudge data. There is no need to provide a false or fake data or create multiple, IDs or multiple profiles. So I don't feel like just for 6 months you have to do it. Rather, and there might be other peers in that particular industrial segment. Why don't you apply there? What's the point of applying in the same place again and again? That's my limited point to you. As far as your question is concerned, yes, there is a way to bypass it. But that is a little unethical and probably we should not go for it. There's a lot of disturbance in audio. Okay, that is done. What other good portals? I think, Saket, I've already answered this question. There are a lot of portals apart from Naukri. There's IIM Jobs. There is Phenom Placement. There is Randstad India. The list that I, in the PPT, which I recently showed you. So there are a lot of platforms. There are a lot of recruiting platforms where you can apply.
I think Saket's question was that sometimes, like while applying with different companies through their websites, you have to put the same data. You have to fill the same data again and again. Okay. And it's I think and they ask for a lot of information, so it takes at least 20 to 25 minutes to just apply for it. So yes. I don't think that there is any way to bypass it actually.
No, there's no way to bypass it, but what you can do smartly is you can, what you can do is, let's say if you're filling that form, if you're filling any form or any, if you're applying on any company's website or portal, what you can do is you can just copy paste that data in one Excel file or maybe a Word file. So later on, you just have to copy and paste it, right? Otherwise, there is no option. If you say that, are they linked to each other or do I need to fill it again and again? Yes, sir. All are different organizations with different database. You have to fill it again and again. There is no option. And sir, you have to do a little bit of hard work. Why to shy away from, putting that data again? I know it is redundancy. It is iteration. It is quite irritating and putting the same data again and again. But you have to do it, right? There is no bypass to that particular thing. Okay, next question. Keshav is asking, being a CA and after getting into audit in Big Four offshore with 1 year experience, having package of 8 lakh plus, should I switch to investment banking research or portfolio management profile at a package of 5 lakhs? If I'm getting an opportunity to start or getting an opportunity or start doing CFA? See, now this is a question. This is a classic question of money versus profile. So you are earning 8 lakh rupees. In short run, it will look very rosy. Like I have an experience of 1 year and I'm earning 8 lakh rupees. So in this 1 year itself, why didn't you pursue CFA and maybe you would have advanced to some other stage, or maybe you have advanced to the second stage or the final stage in CFA? In case if you're starting it out, rather I would say stick to the offshore unit. And appear for the examination, pursue CFA, clear it, and then apply as do this job hunt as a CFA rather than a CA, since you already have a job. Like people who are just starting out, who do not have any job and who do not want to work in offshore units or let's say orthodox traditional audit practice or taxation practice, for them, and they want to pursue their career in investment banking, they have this option of starting out with a boutique or a mid-size investment banking firm, right? Otherwise, if you're already working, if you already are engrossed in some work, already working with an organization, now it completely depends on your call. Like if you really want to relinquish this particular 8 lakh rupees benefit available to you and for the research profile, completely up to you. Completely up to you. That completely depends on your financial condition, and there are various factors. Like there is no one tangent to it. There are various tangents to it. So rather, if you want to connect, we can connect often rather than discussing it here. But in a nutshell, I would suggest better pursue CFA and then search for job as a CFA. Okay, Anurag, doing financial modeling course from this has already been answered. Okay, a very important question Keshav has asked at the end of the interview. Can we ask, sir, how was my interview, or sir, am I selected? My friend, no. Please do not ask for feedback. One of my students who went for Bangalore campus did the same thing with a Big Four, and since it was a campus recruitment program where the employer were taking care of a lot of candidates, one of the HR came to him and said, we are not sitting here to give you feedback. Either you are selected or rejected, you will get to know about the result, but we are not sitting here to give you a feedback. Please do not ask for a feedback. Please do not ask for a feedback. The interviewer is not sitting there to give you any sort of feedback. Even if you ask for a feedback on their web through a mail, you won't get an answer. They will say you do not fit into our culture, or your profile is not matching with us, or the skill set is very different. They will answer this way. They will not give a direct answer that you didn't perform well. Aisa nahi likhenge wo.
And even, you know, like while the interview is going on, just after the interview, if you ask, they will obviously have other candidates also to interview, you know. So, and maybe a lot of candidates will get interviewed after you, and then they will make up their mind. So most of the times while you are giving the interview, the interviewer has himself not made up his mind. And by asking this question, you are portraying to him that how desperate you are for the job. So it's better not to ask that question. And one more thing, while asking the feedback on mail, you can do it just maybe once. If you don't get an answer, then the answer is probably Yes. You did not get selected.
Yes.
Or either you will get an answer that we are still in the process of shortlisting the candidates. We will get back to you. All these things actually, most of the times, 99% of the times, means that you are not selected.
Okay. So Saket is asking how to upload CV here. Probably he's asking about, or he's inquiring about uploading CV on LinkedIn. So there is an option there. I think I need to check that. I'll get back to you over this, right? There is an option, definitely. There is one more question regarding this. Should we upload our CV on this particular platform like LinkedIn or not? Certain students will say, no, sir, our CV is usually circulated, and the points they become common, and common ho jate hain. All that stuff comes out. All that complaints come out. I say, it's completely up to you whether you want to upload it or not. Really doesn't matter. Nobody looks at your CV on LinkedIn. They probably go and visit your profile. Rather, if someone is interested in your candidature, he or she will ask you to mail him your CV. Mail them your CV. So it's better not to upload there, but you can do it. There is no harm in doing it. Like there's nothing like you cannot do it or you should not do it. But the disadvantages outweighs the advantages. Or let's say it is actually indifferent whether you upload it or not. So better not to upload it. Put it on some, you know, recruitment or job portal through media option. Anurag has already answered. Okay. I think earlier, okay. What is more important, to switch to a different company, Big Four brand, to work which has been done there? switch to a different company, Big Four brand of work? Sir, I didn't get your question. Keshav. Okay, thank you, Ankita. Okay. This sort of question is like, I really want to answer this question. Why did I leave EY and started self-employment? Sir, I left Ernst & Young because I wanted to pursue entrepreneurship. I felt that my speaking skills, my mentoring skills were better than my taxation skills, were better than my technical skills. I felt that I'll be able to perform better as a coach, as a teacher, as a trainer, rather than working in a Big Four. I learned a lot of things. See, I come from St. Xavier's, Jaipur, so which is a well-known school in Jaipur. There were a lot of opportunities in St. Xavier's. So I learned a lot of things, even during school time. I was able to implement all those things in terms of drafting mails, in terms of drafting replies, in terms of dealing with client, in terms of interpersonal skills while I was working in Ernst & Young. So all those skills got polished and even better. But later on, when I was working there, I felt this is not my calling. I wanted to do something on my own. And I belong to Jaipur. I was working in, you know, Ernst & Young, Gurgaon. So I left my job. Let me tell you, before that, I was working with Bharti Infratel. So when I was a student, when I was pursuing CA, I had a dream to work in a corporate. I didn't want to work with a Big Four. Just like a lot of, articles, some of you are articles here attending the session, many experts or many seniors of yours will tell you that bahut kaam karate hain Big Four wale, so please don't go and join them. Like it's like complete slogging there. I would say this is your age to slog. Please learn to slog. If you are not slogging today, you will slog later on. Your mental and your physical capabilities will substantially come down as your age increases. So if you are in your 20s, 30s, this is the time to work. In your 40s, 50s, 60s, that's a time to, you know, manage things. Today is a time to manage things. Today is a time to implement things. And that is possible in Big Four, right? So I got selected from Delhi campus in 2013. I am a May 2013 qualified chartered accountant. I got selected in Delhi campus. And they offered only 4 jobs, right? And I was one of them. I'm really proud of that. I started my career with Bharti Infratel Limited. It's a listed company into telecom infrastructure. It's a Bharti Group company. It's an Airtel Group company. I worked there for some time and left it because I didn't like the profile. I wanted to work in taxation, but they were offering me accounts receivable and payable. I didn't want to work in accounts receivable payable. I left that organization and then joined, Ernst & Young Indirect Tax. Worked there for a considerable period of time. Then came back to Jaipur, started my venture. It took some years to establish. And today, by God's grace, probably I'm doing well. And even as a self-employed person, as someone who is running my own business, let me tell you, the struggle is the same. I have to slog it hard. Let's say if you're working in any organization, you will be given some work, you will be given some desk, you will have, you know, your accounts getting credited at the end of the month. You will have everything. You just need to invest your time. But as a self-employed person, you need to find your own office. You need to buy your own laptop. You need to search for your own clients. You need to advertise yourself. You need to market your services. From finance to marketing to sales to HR to everything. To everything. Like you have to do it on your own. So this is the difference between entrepreneurship and being a